Okay, ich begrüße Sie und euch hier im Monarch. Es ist ja sehr, sehr voll und heiß schon mittlerweile, obwohl ihr noch gar nicht so lange hier drin seid. Ich freue mich, neben mir Owen Jones sitzen zu haben. Er ist mir als erstes Mal aufgefallen, als ich sein Buch Chefs in England im Buchladen gesehen habe und mir seine Kritik durchgelesen habe, wie die Arbeiterklasse dämonisiert wird. Dann habe ich öfter mal den Guardian mal reingeguckt und bin immer wieder über seine Artikel gestolpert und fand sie ganz gut und dachte, eigentlich mal eine gute Gelegenheit, wenn er in Berlin ist, mit ihm eine Veranstaltung hier zu machen. Ich will einfach gleich anfangen und dir die folgende Frage stellen. Die Abstimmung über die Loslösung von Großbritannien aus der EU war ja so ein Auftakt einer Reihe von Wahlentscheidungen, also die Wahl von Trump in den USA, aber auch Wählerverlust der SPD und der Linken bei Landtagswahlen und Regionalwahlen in Deutschland an die AfD, bei denen traditionelle Milieus, die früher linke Parteien gewählt haben, nun für rassistische und nationalistisch-protektionistische Wahloptionen ihre Stimme abgaben. In Österreich ist die FPÖ schon lange die stärkste Partei in der Arbeiterschaft. In Frankreich wählen auch viele ehemalige Sympathisanten der Kommunisten, wie Didier Ribon in seinem Buch Rückkehr nach Reims darstellt, nun den Front National. Was hat sich verändert? Die westeuropäische Linke, die zu einer Akademiker- und urbanen Mittelschichtsveranstaltung geworden ist und deshalb die klassischen Wähler linker Parteien nicht mehr anspricht? Oder machen die Rechten wie Trump, Frau Le Pen oder die Brexit-Befürworter, die sich als Anti-Establishment-Bewegung aufführen, ein überzeugenderes Angebot?
Guten Abend, Berlin. That was rubbish. That was rubbish. Don't applaud that. That was... Don't encourage me. Well, first, it is an honour, by the way, to be here. So thank you so much for the invitation. And it's great to see so many people here tonight. Such a quiet year, so little to talk about. Blimey. It's been a long year. I've been aged by this year. Look, at least 15 years old now. I think whenever I get a news alert, I don't know if anybody else has this, I get a news alert on my phone, I just think, all right, 2016, what have you done this time? But in terms of that question, which is obviously all about 2016, really, 2016, a year so bad it's an adjective, that's so 2016, how 2016 is that? What we've seen is a political polarisation across the Western world. And you've got a tidal wave of anger and frustration and resentment, which was bubbling beneath the surface before the financial collapse. But obviously, in terms of the biggest financial crisis since 1929, it had very dramatic political consequences, some of which took a number of years to unfold fully. And that's what we've seen. That's what we've seen this year in quite a dramatic fashion. Now, what we've seen is, overall, that anger and frustration has gone in two very different directions. One, I would argue, is in the direction of a politics of hope, based on a politics of challenging vested interests at the top of society, challenging the people who plunged the Western world into its gravest crisis since the end of the war, and about building a society running the interests of the majority. And we have seen that because I know you've mentioned the weakness of the left and the strength of these new movements of the populist and xenophobic right. But you have had, for example, in the United States of America, a country which was seen as, you know, politically immune to all forms of socialism, that in 2016, of all years, you know, 15 years after the end of the Cold War, and which was spun as the defeat of any alternative to free market capitalism, in the United States, the heartland of free market capitalism, the most successful socialist in its entire history, a septuagenarian Jewish self-described socialist, senator from Vermont, who particularly inspired younger people. 80 to 85% of many people in the primaries who voted for him, of people under 30. And he had this message of an America for the majority, not Wall Street, Main Street rather than Wall Street, and so on. And it was a political earthquake. He didn't win the nomination, but in a normal year, he would have got 1%. He didn't get 1%, he got 46%. Got to remember that. You know, we've seen the rise of Podemos, a party in Spain, a country devastated by the crisis of the last few years, where half of young people were thrown out of work with devastating consequences. Hundreds of thousands of Spanish families driven from their homes, evicted, where you've seen a surge there of poverty, of public services devastated. And a party which was founded not much longer than 2 years ago got 5 million votes in a very short space of time. Podemos, which means we can in English. And it came out of these big social movements. Millions of Spaniards took to the streets. Syriza in Greece, yeah, it got defeated. It's a tiny country, a tiny part of the Eurozone, and they could afford to humiliate it in the way they did. But it was still a symptomatic of a left that was resurgent in various parts of Europe. In my own country, look, there's lots of problems with Labour at the moment. But the fact you got the Corbyn phenomenon, for me, I was always interested in the wave rather than the surfer. But the fact you got that wave in the first place showed the appetite for change. But on the other hand, obviously, we've got the rise of an authoritarian populist xenophobia, which is now sweeping the Western world. In the United States, that proto-fascist clown Donald Trump, a man, you know, who is a, it's the oldest trick in the book, the plutocrat, who pretends to be against the elite, the man of the people, the man of the working American. Now, his whole shtick is that you should blame Mexican immigrants and Muslims for all the problems, the real problems Americans face. He speaks about Muslims as European politicians in the 30s, once spoke about Jews, of course. And in terms of understanding what happened in the United States, on the one hand, racism and misogyny obviously had a very clear role. A group in society who feels belittled and undermined by the rise of the LGBT movement, the civil rights movement and feminism, and that backlash which manifested itself in this horrendous way. The other, because it's not one or the other, some people claim, was obviously economic insecurity colliding with that politics of despair. And that was the fact that working class Americans, their wages have stagnated or fallen for many, many years. And running an establishment candidate, yes, an establishment candidate that got more misogyny than a male establishment candidate, but an establishment candidate at a time when anti-establishment sentiment was sweeping the Western world, well, that was a disastrous decision, if you like, and we've now seen the consequences of that in the United States. But what we've seen in the US, in other countries, very specific to the cultural and historical context of each country, is happening, of course, in different ways. Now, it has been a long year, so in terms of Austria, it is worth bearing in mind, and we'll cling on to any victory we've got here. The Austrian people did tonight reject the far right and their poison. And we need to remember that. The trend of 2016 was booked. The fact that we're applauding the fact that only 46% of the Austrian population voted for the far right shows where we're at, but we will take what we have. But it does show it's not inevitable, and it wasn't an establishment candidate who, of course, defeated the far right. But we've seen it there. We've seen the rise of the National Front, as you've said, in the so-called Red Belt of France, where people once voted for the communists, people now often are voting for the National Front. The National Front are clever because what they do is they combine xenophobia, the scapegoating of Muslims and immigrants for the multiple problems that France suffers, for all of those ills. But they also combine that with a raid on left-wing economic rhetoric. So they posture on the left when it comes to the economy. So they're very clever. We've seen, of course, the rise of the Golden Dawn, the neo-Nazis in Greece. In Scandinavia, in Sweden, the Swedish Democrats, which was born out of the white supremacist movement. In some polls, they were leading in the polls. So it's absolutely the case. We've seen this in different ways. In my own country, Brexit, of course, you can't separate from all of these things. That referendum, above all else, wasn't about the European Union. It was about immigration. Now, the part of Stockport I grew up in voted to leave the European Union. It has many problems, but very few immigrants. And it was, 2% immigrants. And it was a damning indictment of people like me on the left. Because if I think of the problems where I grew up, a lack of affordable housing because of the failure of government to build it, the lowest level of house building since the 1920s in peacetime. Whether it be declining living standards because of government policy, whether it be the lack of secure jobs because they've been ripped from our economy, public services under strain because of the failure of government to invest. But many people, including people I grew up with, see these problems through the prism of immigration, even in areas with very little immigration. And in Britain, it was often the places with the least immigration that voted most decisively to leave the European Union. That's not their fault. It was Bertolt Brecht, the German playwright, to paraphrase him, he said, if you've lost confidence in the people, then dissolve them and elect a new one. If it goes wrong, it's not the people's fault, it's our fault on the left. We have to take responsibility for that. And I think there's been lots of problems with the left. In terms of what we saw in the 1990s, because often you get the cheerleaders of Blairism who argue that's the only, that brand of politics is the only possible route to political, to electoral victory. When Tony Blair became Prime Minister in 1997, his brand of politics was on the march across Europe. Gerhard Schröder here in Germany, not long after him. Jospin in France, in Italy, in Spain, across Scandinavia, in the Netherlands. That's not the case in Europe today at all. Social democratic parties, whether their leaders are on the left or on the right, are all in a mess. Here in Germany, the Social Democrats are led by a leader, as you know, whose politics are broadly those of the so-called third way, of Blairism. But they're on 18 to 22% in the opinion polls. They're hemorrhaging support to the left, to the Greens, and of course to alternate the AfD. You've seen this phenomenon in other countries, in Spain, where you've got, they're losing support to Podemos, in Sweden, to the Swedish Democrats on the far right. And what we saw, because in the 1990s, it was Clintonism and Blairism that was dominant. But earlier this month, a candidate with that brand of politics stood against the proto-fascist and lost badly. I mean, not on the terms of the popular vote, but it should have been an overwhelming majority against someone like Donald Trump, and it wasn't. And that's why we have to ask searching questions, because that brand of politics has failed. But that's not an excuse for people of my brand of politics either, because we can't point to any political successes either. And I think that's the sort of thing we should be talking about, and that's that disconnect between the left as a whole and many working class communities, a failure to communicate in a language that resonates with millions of working class people, the fact that in France the National Front are sweeping across communities whose parents and grandparents once voted for the communists and they're now voting for the far right, that I think we have to ask searching questions. And I think that means, yes, we reject, in my opinion, Blairism and the third way, because they have no successes they can point to today. The world has changed. But equally, we need a movement that is rooted in working class communities in the way that we fail to do so far. And just to finish up on that one, I wrote in Chavs a few years ago about the danger of class being appropriated by the populist right, in that Blairism abandoned the idea of class. It said, we're all middle class now. And my fear was that the populist right would go, working class does matter, the working class does exist, and they are demonised, and they're demonised by the metropolitan left of the major cities who hate you and your values, who want to destroy you with mass immigration and multiculturalism. That's what they're now doing. That's what Trumpism is all about. We're seeing that in Britain under Theresa May. We're seeing that in France. And it is pernicious and it's dangerous. So class politics matters. We've got to talk about class because the left often has become disconnected from it. Yes, the old, you know, all social democratic parties are in crisis for part of the reasons I've already explained. But the left, of which I consider myself a part of, has to ask very searching questions. Because the danger is, if we don't get our act together, however much we cheer tonight the defeat of the Austrian far right, Europe and America are in a very serious crisis, the worst since the end of the war. And unless we get our act together, a vacuum which exists will be filled. And it will be filled by the Marine Le Pens, the Nigel Farages, and the Donald Trumps. So we've got to get our act together. We've got to ask searching questions about our own strategy. We've got to talk about how we communicate to people, because otherwise the danger is we become a subculture with our own ways of speaking, our only ways of communicating, which resonate in our own circles, but out there, we will lose ground in community after community, and the far right will sweep and devastate this continent as they've devastated it before. So this is a wake-up call this year.
Wenn du von Working Class sprichst, wen meinst du damit konkret? Ist es die klassische Industriearbeiterschaft oder die klassische Industriearbeiterschaft und ihre Familien, die vielen Menschen in schlecht bezahlten Dienstleistungsjobs oder jeder, der lohnabhängig beschäftigt ist? Oder gehört zum Begriff Working Class auch eine kulturelle und politische Praxis?
Well, the Working Class for me I have a very kind of broad, inclusive description, which is everybody who works for a living, everybody who has to sell their labour in order to live and lacks control over what they do, which is most people, whether it's the street cleaner or the teacher. It's the majority of society. The working class has never been homogenous. It's always included people who work in the cities or in the countryside, the private or the public sector, people with full-time jobs, part-time jobs, people with very low wages, people who are better paid, men, women, people who were born in the country we're talking about, people who were born elsewhere. We could go on. It's not a homogenous group of people. And my view is that what we need to do is emphasise, you know, because lots of people in other countries, you know, I mean, other than Britain, will call themselves middle class. I would argue they're working class, but what's the point in getting into that kind of argument? It's about those who the wealth creators, the working people who keep society ticking, however they self-describe themselves, and it's about emphasising their common interests. Now, what I would regard as the working class has changed very dramatically in the last 30 years, but longer, but 30 years in particular. When Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto, the majority of working class people were personal servants. And in Britain, that was the case until 1920. The heyday of the industrial working class, it's a very short period in history, 1920s to the early 1960s, maybe. And what we've seen in the last generation is a shift from an industrial working class to a service sector working class. So in Britain, as many people now work in call centres as work down the mines at the peak of the mining industry, for example. Retail is the biggest or one of the biggest employers in Britain as it is elsewhere. Now, I'm not going to glamorise the old working class because these jobs were dirty, backbreaking, often very bad for people's physical health. They often excluded women. The difference is because the new jobs are often cleaner, you know, less physically arduous, less, more inclusive of women, for example. But the difference is you did have communities based around mines, factories, steelworks, where people would work all their lives. You don't have communities based around supermarkets and call centres and offices in the same way. People's jobs are far more transient. People often do temporary jobs. People often do, you know, a low-paid job, unemployment, low-paid job, and so on. So work is far more transient than it used to be. And for me, it's about, you know, some people talk about a precariat, the growth of a very precarious workforce, people who do temporary work, people in who are self-employed officially, but that often means a way of stripping away terms and conditions and security from people. People who are forced to do part-time work, who want part-time work, and so on. But we've always had precarious workers. That's not actually that new. So for me, it's about what we've got to do is emphasise what people have in common. And that is everybody, whether they are working class or middle class, as they define themselves, want a decent wage. They want a decent pension. They want a good house that's affordable in which they can live, that's secure. They want good public services that most of them depend on. Education, healthcare. They want, it's in their interest for the rich to pay their taxes to ensure that they have the standard of living, the majority that people are entitled to. That their next generation, their children, have a standard of living that is better than their own. which is being denied from people all over Europe, whether they are working class or middle class or however they describe themselves. So we have to emphasize that. You know, yes, I wrote a book called The Demonization of the Working Class. I'm saying here that class matters, and it does, and we do need to talk about class. But we've got to do it in a way that unites the majority, because lots of people who I want to win over would say they were emphatically middle class, but they're the still people who suffer the decline or fall in wages. They're still people who suffer from cuts to public services. They're still people whose children are going to be denied the same standard of living that they have. So it's above all else for me, class is about who has wealth and power and who doesn't. Who has been made to pay for the crisis that has enveloped Europe and America over the last few years? And who is responsible for that crisis? So we've got to start talking about that. And it does mean, you know, the whole point of class politics is it's about challenging vested interests who dominate our society, of societies rigged in favour of tiny elites. If we don't talk about that on the left, the populist right, as I've said, will do that. They will redefine the elite. Because people are angry at the moment, and they're angry because their lives are suffering. They want someone to blame. Now, unless we get our act together, then people will blame Muslims and immigrants and unemployed people, as they're doing all over Europe at the moment. But our argument is you should be angry. You should blame people for the situation you're in. But you should blame the bankers who plunged this country and all of the West into economic disaster. The people who won't pay their taxes, unlike you. The businesses who won't pay proper wages to the to millions of workers all over Europe. The politicians who are all too often in, you know, who stand up for the interests of these people rather than your own. So we have to have our own populism. It's a dirty word often. It's got difficult connotations. But people are angry at the moment. And our argument is, whether you're working class or middle class, you are being screwed over. You are being made to pay for a crisis you had nothing to do with. But it is not those immigrants, and it's not those unemployed people, and it's not those Muslims who are responsible. It's the people at the top of society who have got away with causing this crisis, which has devastated your living standards, which is going to make your children suffer in a way that you never, ever expected. And we've got to make that message very, very clear.
Ich will nochmal auf den Brexit zurückkommen, weil das sicherlich ja hier die vielen Briten, die bestimmt hier heute im Publikum sind, interessieren und mich als einer, der gern auf die Insel fährt, um da die Pubs zu besuchen. Und zwar, wie wirkt sich denn das Wählervotum so konkret aus? Kann man sagen, dass sozusagen eine andere Stimmung auf der Straße ist? Gibt es mehr rassistische Übergriffe? Gibt es mehr fremdenfeindliche Sprüche von Leuten, die das früher nicht so sich getraut hätten zu sagen? Oder ist der ganze Hype um den Brexit eigentlich mehr einen, wie soll man sagen, intellektuellen Diskurs, den eigentlich nur die Leute interessieren, die eh, was ich, zwei Tageszeitungen lesen.
No, Brexit's going really well, everything's fine. Oh, it's a right palaver, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, it is, oh God, sorry, I'm supposed to, sorry. Yeah, Brexit. I think the point I said earlier, it was a campaign waged on immigration. And we should have a discussion about immigration. It's not about, there's this argument on the left that if people talk about immigration in a way that we're not comfortable with, we shut them down as xenophobes and racists. And I don't agree with doing that. We need an honest, open discussion. That referendum was anything but. It was a poisonous, bigoted campaign which injected xenophobia and racism into mainstream public life in a way that has unleashed terrible demons which are now causing, well, devastating consequences. So if we just think about what happened during that referendum, you had the leaders of the official Leave campaign arguing that immigrants posed a threat as rapists, terrorists, as murderers. They drew up a list of EU nationals who had raped or murdered British citizens. It's a sort of comment you normally get under the, you know, the comment section of newspapers, except it was an official referendum campaign. Whether it be this lie, an outright lie that Turkey would join the European Union, which will not happen in the lifetime of a single person in this room, and that therefore Britain would be inundated with with Turkish criminals, where you got Nigel Farage, who stood in front of a poster.
Indeed.
It's like pantomime, this. Love it. He stood in front of this poster, Breaking Point, it said, with dark-skinned refugees behind it who obviously were fleeing persecution and so on. And during that campaign, a British Labour MP was murdered by a far-right fanatic who yelled, "Death to traitors, freedom for Britain." And then Nigel Farage, after the referendum, said that this was a revolution, except this time it was won without a single shot being fired. Now, it was, I think, so alarming, because I wrote during the referendum campaign that whatever the result, the venom of that campaign, the sheer bigotry, and the thing is about, you know, Boris Johnson, our foreign secretary, which is worth letting that sink in for a while. It's like a, yeah, I mean, you either laugh or you just sit in the corner in the fetal position, rocking and dribbling. No, you know, who went on about Barack Obama's half Kenyan heritage and that's why he opposed Brexit and all the rest. And they didn't believe any of this. It doesn't matter. They didn't really believe Turkey was going to join the European Union. It was all the device in which, of course, to win. And they incited bigotry, and that has consequences. And it's not the case that 52% of people in Britain voted that way because they're racist. Just not true. But racists think that 52% of people voted in support. They thought they had a mandate. So in the aftermath, hate crime soared in Britain. I spoke to a young Romanian woman a few days afterwards, and she said she was scared to leave the house. She said she thought the country hated her. You know, BBC journalists and others, amongst others, whether they be because of their accent, the colour of their skin, who were abused in the streets. And what we've seen, I think, is it was a real struggle particularly for black and minority ethnic Britons for many years to drive certain forms of overt racism away from the mainstream. It's just been re-injected back there with devastating consequences. So I think the problem is, you know, when we talk about how Britain voted to leave, we voted to leave on the basis of an inflammatory anti-immigration campaign. And the problem is across Europe at the moment, because you can't, as I've said, you've got to link all of these phenomena, Trumpism, Brexit, the National Front. It's very authoritarian in its nature. And what we saw, for example, just one example, many people in this room will know this, but the government was taken to court, and it was taken to court over Article 50, which is, of course, the article of the EU, which as soon as you activate Article 50, you begin the process of leaving the European Union in a two-year process. The government argued that they should activate Article 50 at a time of their choosing. Now, the referendum campaign was waged partly, in theory, to restore parliamentary sovereignty. So they were taken to court with the argument that Parliament should decide when Article 50 should be triggered, and it should be debated first. So it wasn't overturning the referendum at all. It was just saying that Parliament should decide and it should debate the issue. It should debate how it happens and all the rest to help shape the terms of negotiation that Britain has. The government lost. And what we saw was the front page of the Daily Mail, the second biggest newspaper in the country. The headline was "Enemies of the People," with the pictures of all the judges. It's the sort of rhetoric you get in dictatorships. That's what happened in Stalinist Russia. The Sun, their front page, denounced the a rich foreign elite subverting British public opinion, which is a bit odd coming from a newspaper owned by Rupert Murdoch. He's an Australian, born American oligarch who lives anyway. But nonetheless, and you got this populist again. It's a right wing populism, and what it does is it defines dissent as treason. That if you are critical at all of what's happening, then you are disloyal to your own country. And, you know, we've seen other front page headlines attacking Remainers as being, as they call those who voted Remain, as though Leave won a 98% victory rather than 52-48%, as though the 48% have no say over the future of their own country. So it's a very intolerant and authoritarian atmosphere. And it's similar to Trump in that it's this phenomenon of the bitter winner, of the sour winner, the winner who acts like they've lost. So, you know, you look at Trump's timeline, he writes as though he's a bitter loser. He's lost an election. I mean, he did lose the popular vote, so he's a loser. But he keeps going on and attacking his critics as though he lost. And it's the same with the Brexiteers. They keep denouncing those who voted Remain. And what they're going to do is all the problems that are going to happen, of which there are many, they're just going to blame people who voted Remain. They're going to say it's them subverting British, you know, the British verdicts, the democratic say of the British people. They're disloyal to their own country. They're in the service of a foreign power. And we've heard all this before. And everything that goes wrong, they'll blame on them. And it's very dangerous and sinister. So I think it is a very big threat to British democracy. And it's very similar to what we're seeing in the United States and elsewhere. And that's something we have to be very wary of, because I do fear, and I'm sure many people in this room fear for the future of their country in a way they've never had to do so before. And the danger is allowing them to portray us as the elite, which is what they're doing. The 48% of the population who voted Remain, that's quite a big elite, as it turns out. But they're going to claim that's the elite, they're responsible for all our problems. So we need to, if there's an us and them, and there is an us and them, it's whether you voted Remain or Leave, you're struggling to get an affordable house because of the government won't build them, you're lacking often a secure job, your children you fear are going to have a worse lot in life than you, if you're an older person, you're often shivering in a cold home because you're scared to pay your gas bill. We need to make it clear the big dividing line in our society is not Remain versus Leave, but it's about the majority against those at the top of society. And if we allow the right-wing tabloid media, owned by billionaires and millionaires, to argue they're the voices of the people and we're the elite, then obviously our country has a bad future. But I do think we can have a genuine progressive left which argues you should be angry with the people at the top, but it's not us, it's those people, and you should be very angry with them indeed.
Ich möchte nochmal historisch bei den schlechten Ereignissen einen Schritt zurückgehen. Als ich 1979 geboren wurde, kam auch Margaret Thatcher an die Macht. Und meine Frage ist, also von wem wurde sie damals gewählt? Und vor allen Dingen, warum wurde sie immer wieder gewählt, wenn sie so viel Übel über die Arbeiterklasse und die einfachen Leute gebracht hat? Was war sozusagen die Motivation? Oder sind das die gleichen Leute, die heute für den Brexit stimmen?
Very good point. Thatcher, blimey, that's a biggie, isn't it? I think the point, look, every single time that the Conservatives have won a majority since 1955 was they won on a lower share of the vote than the time before. So she did never won a landslide. Our electoral system is first past the post. I don't support that electoral system, but that's the one they have. So that means you can win a big, big majority even if a minority of people voted for you. So the highest she ever got was 44% of the vote, but that gave her about 65% of the seats. So that's how electoral system works. And her opposition was very, very divided. In the early 1980s, the Labour Party was in civil war, in stark contrast to its current position. And a big chunk of the Labour Party left to form the Social Democratic Party. So in 1983, the Conservatives won less votes than the time before, but they won a lot more seats because you got, the Labour Party against the Social Democrats in lots of seats, and the Tories just came through the middle. So they won less votes, but it didn't matter because the opposition was so divided. But then again as well, of course, the left made many mistakes. The left in the 1970s was very, very triumphalist because there was a crisis of capitalism in the 1970s, and there's this view on the left sometimes that if capitalism is in a mess, then the left will succeed inevitably. But that's not really ever been the case, because in the 1930s, you had a massive crisis of capitalism, and who was victorious in the 30s? It was fascism. In the 70s, it was what we, in the clunky way, often call neoliberalism. It was Thatcherism and the rest. In the current economic crisis, it was those who supported cuts and also the populist xenophobic right. So it's never been the case the left automatically succeed. But in the 70s, there was that sense. You know, I think about I'm not attacking my parents, so you know, but my parents met through the left, and in the 1970s, they thought history was on their side. And you know, the right thought they were going to lose. They felt terrified in the 1970s. In the 1970s, there was rumors of, you know, MI5 planning a coup. And newspapers openly spoke about right-wing, you know, the military taking over in the case of a left-wing Labour government. So it was a very different time. But the left made a lot of miscalculations, because what you got in the 1970s, you got the oil shock in 1973. So inflation went up, and that caused a massive crisis in Britain and elsewhere. As living standards began to go down, as prices went up, lots of trade unionists went on strike to defend their existing wages, and that caused this massive, you know, crisis in British society that Thatcherism exploited. You got the collapse of the international framework, so-called Bretton Woods. All of these things meant that the West was in a big economic crisis, but the right was better placed to exploit it. So it was a very different time, and the left made a lot of very serious mistakes. But no, the Brexiteers are not the same as Thatcherism. In fact, many of the communities that suffered most from Thatcherism are the ones that voted for Brexit. These are Labour constituencies, not, you know, these are ex-mining communities. So ex-mining communities, ex-steelwork communities. A lot of the people who voted for Brexit, if you ask them about Thatcher, would probably use a lot of expletives. So it's just not the case there's an overlap between the two at all. There's always been a tradition of working class conservatism in Britain. That's absolutely the case. And Thatcher actually didn't do as well in working class communities as previous conservatives did. In the 1950s, Liverpool voted conservative. That's not the case in the 1980s onwards. Liverpool is as anti-conservative a city now as you will get. In Sheffield, in Manchester, in other northern cities, the conservatives went into decline after the 1980s. They used to be actually quite strong there. But what you did get are communities that suffered from massive deindustrialization that felt very angry. And for a lot of them, they saw this referendum, not about being about the European Union, not an issue most people really think about and have thought about over the last few years. They saw on the ballot paper, do you support the status quo, yes or no? If your community has been devastated for many, many years, there's a lack of secure jobs, a lack of decent, affordable housing, you're worried about the future of your kids, then you might look at that ballot paper and think, well, no, I'm not happy. I'm not going to vote yes in a referendum called by an eaten, educated Conservative Prime Minister, backed up by what the City of London, various big businesses saying it'll be economic chaos if you vote the wrong way. I'm going to vote no. I'm going to stick my fingers up at all of them. And the Remain campaign, the official Remain campaign, I was part of a left-wing Remain campaign called Another Europe is Possible, which argued to vote to stay in order to change it. But the official Remain campaign said, if you vote the wrong way, then you'll suffer massive economic insecurity. But a lot of people who voted to leave said, my life is already defined by economic security. You can't tell people who feel they have nothing to lose that they will lose everything. So it is actually the case that many of the victims of Thatcherism, many of the people who suffered most because of her policies, and many of the people who voted against her over and over again, many of those people, particularly in the North East, in Wales, which voted to leave the European Union, which voted to reject Margaret Thatcher in the 1980s, they saw it as a rejection of economic policies that had devastated them. I think that was wrong. It's a failure of the left to put that in context and to argue for something very different. But it certainly was the case that Thatcherism, as well as the policy of cuts over the last few years, are one of the main reasons so many communities voted to leave. Absolutely no question about that at all.
Wir haben dich auch eingeladen, weil in Großbritannien eine Entwicklung viel früher und viel härter durchgezogen wurde als bei uns. Ich möchte auf eine davon zu sprechen kommen, was in Berlin viele Leute bewegt, und zwar was unter dem Schlagwort Gentrifizierung fällt, dass sozusagen Berliner Mieterinnen und Mieter zu Recht Angst haben, dass sich Berlin zu so einem Immobilienmarkt wie London entwickelt. Versuch uns doch mal kurz zu erklären, wie es dazu kam, dass in vielen Teilen von London so unglaublich hohe Mieten zu bezahlen sind. Und vielleicht kannst du auch so ein paar Tipps oder Anregungen geben. Was können soziale Bewegungen oder was kann jetzt hier eine linke Regierung, die in Berlin jetzt regiert seit oder ab Dezember regiert, was sie machen kann, um einen solchen Prozess Einhalt zu gebieten, dass es hier nicht so ein Immobilienmarkt wird wie in London.
So, yeah, the housing crisis in housing crisis and gentrification. I think, look, if you look at, say, London is one of the richest cities on earth, and you get new build properties that are built in the centre of London that are bought up by often, well, you know, oligarchs from Russia, often left vacant. You know, you can cycle past them, as I do, and all the windows are dark because no one lives there. Whilst in London, one of the richest countries on the richest cities on the face of the earth, one in four young people grow up in an overcrowded home. And that has devastating consequences. If you grow up in an overcrowded home, it has a big impact on your health, your education, your well-being. You're more likely to suffer from everything from asthma to anxiety and depression. And it damages not just their potential, but the potential of a society. If you damage the well-being of your children, you damage the well-being of the future of your country, by definition. Now, in terms of the housing crisis in Britain, which I think, you know, reveals a lot about, always, you know, very emblematic about what's happening elsewhere. London was supposed to be different from somewhere like Paris. In Paris, you have this so-called donut effect, where very affluent Parisians live in the centre, and then you have the banlieue, the kind of ghettoised suburbs, where often people from immigrant backgrounds are left in terrible circumstances. And in Britain, after World War II, the founder of our National Health Service was someone called Nye Bevan, as many people know in this room. And he, at the time, housing was part of the health ministry, because it was seen as so integral to people's well-being. And he launched a programme of council housing. And the council housing, the public housing, the instruction was that they should be of a better quality than private housing. And he said, critically, he wanted it to support mixed communities. He said, I want to recreate the lovely features of the Welsh and English village, where the doctor and the butcher live next door to each other. And you did, to a degree, till the 1970s, council housing did support people from different sorts of backgrounds. In the 1980s, a policy was introduced, a very clever policy, called Right to Buy. What that meant was people living in council housing could buy their own house that they were renting from the council at a massive discount. And what's so clever about Right to Buy, I don't often quote Ronald Reagan, obviously, but he said, when you're explaining, you're losing. If you come up with a policy that forces your opponent to explain in great detail their position, they've lost the argument already. And with Right to Buy, they'd say to people on the left, often, you own your own home, because in Britain, bear in mind, unlike Germany, home ownership is something which people are, you know, encouraged to aspire to. Most people have mortgages or own their own homes outright in Britain. So everyone is seen to aspire to that. You know, an Englishman's home is his castle and all the rest. So they said, you own your own homes. Why won't you let working class people own their own homes as well? And it was all it meant in practice was, yes, people got to own their own homes, some people in the 1980s, but what homes were their children supposed to have? Because we didn't build council housing to replace the council housing that we sold. So public housing went into a state of collapse. And what it meant was the next generation, home ownership now is in free fall. Home ownership levels now are where they were in the mid-1980s. Amongst younger people, they've gone down by about 40% in the last 5 years alone. And because council housing isn't being built, they're forced to go into the private rented sector instead. And the private rented sector in Britain has no controls of any kind, unlike in Germany and Berlin. It's completely, you know, it's totally unregulated in comparison. So people can be evicted with 2 months' notice, if that. Their rents go much higher than their income is going up. So in London, one in four people need housing benefit. They need money from the state so they can afford to pay their rent. So we spend far more on housing benefit than we do on building any housing in Britain, which is a total waste of money. But what it's meant in London, particularly, but other cities as well, is people can't afford to live in the middle anymore. So you end up with a situation where the old council housing that was sold off was bought up by private landlords. So about 40% of the council housing sold off was taken on by landlords, who then rented out the properties, but at a far higher rent than it used to be rented out by the council. People can't afford to do that. So what that did is push people further and further out. If you combine that, home ownership being out of reach, rents being too high, we also had cuts to social security. So cuts to benefits meant people were pushed out as well. In London, people's wages have stagnated or fallen. Every single year, the proportion of the workforce on low wages has gone up. So all of this has meant, increasingly, large parts of London are no-go areas if you're not rich enough. So you end up with the cleaners of mansions and big houses in the centre of London, and they get the night bus at 4 o'clock in the morning, travelling miles across London to clean the houses of people who probably earn in a day what they get in a month. And that's obviously how housing increasingly works. What do we do about it? Well, we need to do a number of things about it. We need to build council housing again. Local authorities need the power and the resources to build council housing. That would create jobs. It would stimulate the economy, because it's not just good for construction. It would also stimulate all the other industries that are dependent on construction as well, particularly for young people in places like Britain, where youth unemployment and underemployment is so much higher than it is here in Germany. It would mean we'd spend less money on housing benefit, on social security. What we also need to do is regulate the private rented sector. So that means limits on how much people's rents can go up, and limits in terms of, or rules put down in terms of where you get secure tenancy agreements, where people can't be evicted with very, very short notice. Because you can't set down roots and have children and have families if you don't know where you're going to be living in a year or even 6 months or less. So these are the sorts of policies we need. We need to control rents, we need rent security, we need to build public housing and invest in public housing as well. And also in London, under Boris Johnson, our previous mayor in London, he redefined affordable housing to mean 80% of market rents. That's not affordable. In much of London, that means you've got to be on £60,000, £70,000 a year. The vast majority of people aren't on it. So if you have new housing projects, then at least, you know, half of those housing projects should be genuinely affordable. That is social rents that people can afford to live in. Because otherwise what you end up with is a situation where the centre of major cities across Europe become playgrounds for the rich, where people on middle incomes or poorer incomes are driven out and ghettoised increasingly, and left with very little provision. Their community's not properly invested in, as we see in Paris. That shouldn't be the future. We should support mixed communities where people from different backgrounds can live alongside each other. And the sorts of policies we're promoting in Britain are doing the exact opposite. So if you get a good left-wing bill in government here, book the trend of 2016, please, honestly. It's not even funny anymore, is it? But if you do that, that means to encourage them to ensure that you have a properly regulated private rented sector, but also to invest in public housing, not just in the suburbs, but in the centre of Berlin as well, to make sure people in every single community, you get people from all backgrounds living next to each other rather than turning it into a playground for the rich.
Der zweite Aspekt, wo ich glaube, die britische Gesellschaft in schlechter Weise viel, viel weiter ist, ist der neoliberale Umbau des Staates, also die Privatisierung ehemaliger staatlicher Dienstleistungen und Vorsorgeeinrichtungen. Margaret Thatcher, ich hatte es ja gesagt, kam 1979 an die Macht. Wie wirkt sich das jetzt aus, 37 Jahre nachdem sie gewählt wurde? Kannst du vielleicht mal uns ein paar Beispiele nennen? Wie wirkt sich neoliberale Politik konkret auf, die wir Berliner einfach verstehen?
consequences of Thatcherism. Well, what Thatcherism did was create a new political settlement. So that means you force your opponents to accept what the underlying principles of what you did. So after World War II, the Labour government of Clement Attlee forced the Conservatives to support things like higher taxes on the rich, nationalisation of key sectors of the economy, stronger trade unions, basic workers' rights and all the rest. That was a new settlement that everybody had to support. And Thatcherism rebelled against that. It felt that the Conservatives had surrendered to that consensus, to socialism as they saw it. So what Thatcherism did is create a new settlement. And the consequences we see today are the housing crisis, as I've said, the selling off of council housing, the failure to replace it, leaving hundreds of thousands of families on waiting lists for council housing, whether it be overcrowding, obviously, whether it be a unregulated private rented sector with insecurity and all the rest. That's one aspect. Another aspect, the devastation of industrial communities in Britain. Britain in the early 1980s went through the most rapid and extreme deindustrialisation of any major Western country at the time since the end of World War II. And what that meant was, you know, communities that often existed to support mines or factories, those mines or factories disappeared, leaving those communities bereft of a purpose almost. And those communities, many of them, have never recovered. And what happened in Britain is many of those jobs were replaced with lower paid and more insecure work, like supermarkets and call centres. And if you go, I went to say Ashington, it's a town in the northeast of England, which used to be a mining community. And that is a community which just has never recovered. There's a lack of secure, well-paid jobs for people. And that has lots of other consequences, from, you know, antisocial behaviour to crime, because for many young people, there's very little to look forward to, aspire to. There's little structure in life. So that has a terrible consequence as well. A dramatic rise in inequality for lots of reasons, because taxes on the rich and big business were massively slashed. Indirect taxes on working people and poorer people were increased, like VAT, the amount, you know, so-called, you know, a flat tax you pay on certain products, which disproportionately affects working people and poorer people. So the privatisation of sections of the economy with devastating consequences. So whether it be the energy companies, we now... I mean, this was ironic because Margaret Thatcher, she did this speech in 1988 at Bruges saying... We didn't roll back the frontiers of the state in Britain, only to have them reimposed at the European level, which is ironic because a lot of our services got sold off and taken over by European governments, the German or French governments, for that matter. The government supports nationalisation in Britain as long as it's any other government but their own, like the Chinese government, for that matter. So, but we ended up with very fragmented, you know, whether it be energy companies, the rail companies, just after Thatcher... admittedly was Prime Minister, but continuing her policies. And these are very unpopular in Britain because you get, you know, in take our rail companies, they're very inefficient, some of the highest, most expensive tickets in the Western world, often very unreliable, overcrowded because of the failure to invest in new trains. And that's emblematic of, you know, whether it be privatisation of energy, of water, where, you know... where, because they won't invest in services, you get massive water leakages with massive impact on people's prices and the bills they pay. We could go on. But that also had an impact on, you know, in other ways, because a lot of these formerly nationalised industries had apprenticeships for younger people, which disappeared with privatisation. And what we saw with deindustrialisation was the disappearance. If you left school at the age of 16... Yes, more if you're a man than if you're a woman. It was often very male-dominated. But you could leave school at the age of 16, get an apprenticeship, and get a secure job. And many of those apprenticeships disappeared along with those jobs as well. So what we have in Britain as a consequence of Thatcherism today is massive inequality, the lack of often secure jobs in many of the communities that suffered deindustrialisation, and a housing crisis. But one, probably the most dramatic... impact of Thatcherism was the deregulation of the financial sector. So Thatcherism consciously promoted policies that meant we diminished manufacturing and industry in favour of the financial sector, which obviously was allowed to expand at a huge rate. That was always problematic because, for example, tax avoidance in finance was always much higher than it was in industry. So the taxes you got from finance were often significantly less than from manufacturing. That what it meant is we were more exposed to financial shocks. So New Labour failed to regulate the city themselves, following on what Thatcherism did. And when the financial crisis hit, it meant Britain was particularly exposed because of Thatcherism's policies. So we suffer today the terrible consequences of Thatcherism, which is a low-paid workforce with insecure jobs, a lack of secure and affordable housing, public services which have been sold off to private profiteers, and a financial sector that was deregulated with terrible consequences. So we live, despite the fact it was so long ago, we very much live with the aftermath.
Neben Labour gibt es ja auf der Insel noch eine andere linke Partei, die SNP aus Schottland, die auch mit Die Linke zusammen eine Fraktion bildet in einem Europaparlament. Was ich mich immer so ein bisschen gefragt habe, ist, wo ist denn eigentlich der große Unterschied zwischen der englischen und der schottischen Gesellschaft, dass sozusagen so einen Impuls gibt, sich zu trennen, und dann in deutschen Zeitungen wird immer die SNP als linksnationalistisch bezeichnet. Ich komme aus dem Teil der Linken, der immer ein sehr kritisches Verhältnis hat zum Nationalismus, auch zum Linksnationalismus. Deswegen meine Frage ist, was ist an der SNP links? Und was ist an ihr nationalistisch? Und würde denn die schottische Gesellschaft, wenn sie sich dann trennt von der englischen, würde es dort mehr Sozialstaat geben, mehr staatliche Regulationen oder vielleicht sogar ein bisschen Sozialismus? Oder ist das alles Humbug?
Right, the Scottish National Party, are they a left-wing party? I'm not sure about that, to be honest. No, actually, to be fair, because I think what the SNP are complicated. They do have a left wing within them. There's an MP called Mary Black, who I'm a big fan of. She's 20, lots of fans here. She's 21 years old, and she's probably one of the most compelling parliamentarians today. I would say she's a socialist, and there is a socialist wing within the SNP, but they're complicated because, like a lot of nationalist forces, they're bound together by one particular issue, which is independence for Scotland. If independence happened, then they would probably split apart and you'd have a more left-wing and a right-wing version, probably. Because the SNP used to argue for lower corporation tax, that you'd have an independent Scotland which would attract business on the Irish model. Ireland obviously went into economic meltdown, so they reversed on that one. And then they said their inspiration was more Nordic countries instead. But in terms of Scotland, it's interesting because in the 1950s, the majority of Scots voted Conservative. In 1955, it was the Unionist Party, the sister party, the Conservatives, and more Scots voted for them as a percentage than the English did. It was over 50% of Scotland. So it shows how quickly things can change. But Scotland was the heartland of the Labour Party. It's where, you know, the first leader, Keir Hardie, I name a cat after him, sure I'd be honoured. And Keir Hardie was Scottish. All the first leaders of Labour were Scottish. And that's, you know, their roots were very much, you know, in terms of Glasgow, the Clyde and elsewhere, places in Scotland which Labour just wouldn't exist without. And what happened was Scottish Labour basically, committed suicide effectively. I mean, what you saw was in Scotland, you saw, you know, Scotland suffered very badly under Thatcherism. You got deindustrialisation on an epic scale. The so-called poll tax, which was a tax introduced in the 1980s or late 1980s onwards, whereby everybody had to pay the same amount of council tax, however rich or poor they happened to be. The first protest I was ever on was in 1990 in Glasgow, because Scotland was the place where they experimented with the tax first. And it's my proudest political moment. I started a chant, stop the poll tax, didn't know what I was chanting. But out of pity, other people chanted it as well. But anyway, but you had this big movement there, and people in Scotland felt very resentful because they felt they suffered the worst consequences of Thatcherism, even though they voted against it. And it was very, it was this huge frustration and anger. And obviously a sense of what grew was, why are we locked into a country where we keep getting governments we don't want, we suffer the consequences, we don't want them. And that's what's driven a lot of independence sentiment. Labour shifted, obviously under New Labour, and left to the right, and left a big vacuum in Scottish politics, which the Scottish National Party could fill. They could say to a lot of people, we're basically the Labour Party you used to vote for. They're gone now. And we're filling, we're now the, you know, the real Labour Party that you once knew. And also Scottish Labourism, that it was a quite a rotten, corrupt party in lots of ways, where you got MPs who didn't bother talking to their constituents because they had such big majorities. They thought they'd be elected every single election. There was very little they had to do. So it was a very macho, male-dominated party with very little roots in Scottish society in the end. And it just needed a big, it just needed a big push to throw it, to destroy it, basically. And what happened during the referendum in 2014 was Scottish Labour formed an alliance with the Scottish Conservative Party, who had traditionally by then been less popular than cholera in Scotland. And they formed this alliance against independence. Now, I think Labour should, of course, my own view, it's not everyone's view, lots of my family voted for independence in Scotland. And just on that, there was this view that support for independence was this brave heart nationalism. But it wasn't. It was people often who felt angry at a society rigged in favour of a tiny elite, who felt the only way of getting a just Scotland was to form their own country. But Scottish Labour should have had their own campaign. But instead, they allied with the Conservatives in a campaign of fear. And it was a campaign of fear. It was a case of lining up with big businesses to threaten Scotland with terrible consequences if they voted the wrong way. And you'll get now people who voted for Labour all their life, their parents, their grandparents, their great-grandparents voted for Labour, and they hate the Labour Party now. They, you know, they have the bitterness of an ex-lover and the passion of the convert. And they will call the Labour Party the Red Tories. That's what they call them often. And it is that absolute anger and fury that had been building up for a very long time. And the referendum, because of how it happened, kind of, you know, if you like, it brought that anger to the surface. Now, would an independent Scotland be more left-wing? Well, it depends who would win out, because there are lots of people who support independence who have no interest in a socially just Scotland. One of the corporate, the traditional corporate bank supporters of independence is Brian Suter, who's a millionaire who runs one of the privatised rail companies, who ran his own referendum once against LGBT rights. Obviously, his view of independence is very different from Mary Black, who openly calls for an independent socialist Scotland. So who would win out? I'm not sure. The oil price collapse has meant that there's a big deficit in Scotland. So it would obviously mean what economic policies would they have? Because Scotland currently would have one of the biggest deficits in Europe because of that oil price collapse. So it's an open question. I don't know what would happen. In terms of, you know, the right, you know, in terms of the independence, if there's another independence referendum, after the EU referendum, you just can't blame people in Scotland for wanting to leave. They voted to stay in the European Union. They're now stuck with the consequences. They, you know, vote against Conservative governments. They still get stuck with them. You know, if you ended up, if in Britain, if you had a referendum and on the ballot paper it said, do you want to be free of Conservative governments forever? I suspect a lot of people would vote yes. And that's what people in Scotland feel. That's what they feel. That's how people feel. So that's what's driving it. So I absolutely understand it. And that's why I think the point about independence is I passionately believe in the right to national self-determination in the same way I believe in the right to divorce. That doesn't mean I think everybody should divorce, but it is up to them to decide. If you look at Spain, for example, at the moment, they won't let Catalonia have a say on whether they have an independence referendum. It's like being in a relationship where one of you goes, do you know what? I'm just not sure I'm into you anymore. I don't think it's going to work. And the other person goes, well, tough, vetoed. You're stuck with me forever. Nothing you can do about it. And obviously, I don't approve of that. And I do think at the moment with Scotland, it's like a, It's like a marriage where they're still living together. One of them's gone, not really into this, not going to lie, but they're worried if they could afford a separate flat. So it's not about love. It's not about love and affection. That's all it is. But my own view is, you know, whatever Scotland decides, I want English, Welsh and Scottish people in the way they've always done, the National Health Service, the welfare state, workers' rights, women's rights, LGBT rights, all of the rights and freedoms we have were won because Scots, English and Welsh people stood together and won them. So whatever the future of Scotland, whatever they decide, and I understand how frustrated they are about the current situation, there are those of us in England and Wales who still want to stand with them to fight for the rights and freedoms our ancestors fought for at such cost and at such sacrifice. And it's a great tradition that we have, a different tradition from the other Britain, which is about empire and aristocracy and big business and all the rest. It's the other Britain that stood up for all of those things. And I don't think an independent Scotland would mean all of a sudden there'd be this great socialist Scotland and that would be good for England and Wales either. But it is up to the Scottish people that whatever they decide, we do have common traditions together of fighting against the same people. And I want us to carry on fighting against them, whatever people decide.
Du hast schon öfter jetzt die Labour Party angesprochen und zur Vorbereitung auf diese Veranstaltung habe ich mir ein Video angeguckt, also wo du Jeremy Corbyn interviewst und du hast ihn in dem Video gefragt, wofür die Labour Party jetzt steht und meine Frage an dich, wofür steht sie und oder was hat er dir gesagt, wofür sie steht und stimmt das, was er gesagt hat, oder war das nur ein bisschen Wahlwerbung?
Cool. So, what does Labour stand for? And I interviewed Jeremy Corbyn, and what he told me, is it true? Well, the Labour Party was founded in 1900, originally, in order to give a political voice to working people. And it was on the basis that you had two parties, the Liberals and the Conservatives, that represented the interests of the rich. And the idea was that working people should have a voice, a political voice as well, because it wasn't enough to just campaign and to have trade unions. That was important. It wasn't enough to win strikes. It wasn't an interest to win the odd local campaign. You had to get people in government as well to introduce policies that could change society as a whole, which is what Labour did, the National Health Service, the welfare state, workers' rights, women's rights, and all the rest. And for me, because sometimes in Britain there's this argument, is Labour a social movement or is it a party of government? And it has to be both. Because we had lots of social movements before 1900 who would take to the streets and campaign and protest, and they did win things, but the problem is they could be taken away very quickly by those with power. So you needed laws and policies implemented as well. So Labour has to be both. And now Labour is the biggest, by some estimates anyway, the biggest left-of-centre party in Europe. It has over 600,000 members. It's trebled in the last year and a half or so. So you've got lots of people with potential to organise in their own communities. That isn't happening to the degree I want, to be honest, at the moment. Lots of people have joined to vote for Jeremy Corbyn. They haven't always gone out in their own communities yet. There needs to be a strategy to do that. But you also need to win power as well, and sometimes there's a sense of winning power is Blairite, but winning power to implement Blairite policies is Blairite. Winning power to implement socialist policies is socialism, and it isn't just about government, because, you know, you didn't get the NHS or workers' rights or women's rights just because governments introduced policies. People had to fight for them for many, many generations. You had to have, you know, LGBT activists, workers, trade unions, all the rest. They campaigned within their communities and they forced those issues on the agenda. And everything we have was won because of the courage and determination of our ancestors. And what Labour often did in power was because people did that in the first place. So the two have to come together. But in terms of what Labour has to stand for today, well, it has to stand for lots of things. It has to stand on the basis that we should invest in the economy rather than cut. That's been vindicated because all of the Conservatives' economic policies have failed on their own terms. They said they'd wipe out the deficit in one term. They didn't get through half. They said they'd start paying off the debts. They added more debt than every Labour government put together. They presided over the worst economic growth since the 19th century, the worst fall in wages since Queen Victoria was on the throne in the 19th century, a productivity crisis so bad that if French workers took every Friday off, France would still be more productive than Britain. So there's this massive economic failings, and George Osborne had all these fiscal rules, and they all collapsed this year. So and you had Conservatives arguing for a fiscal stimulus in the economy. So we've got to argue for investment, not cuts, and the polling shows a massive collapse in support for cuts. So Labour has to make that case as well. Whether it be, for example, on modernising the economy, infrastructure in Britain is terrible, outside of London in particular, whether it be, rail, whether it be, in terms of urban infrastructure. So it's about making that case for modernising the economy. But what Labour are failing at the moment and what we have to work on is things like older people. So, and this is a problem across Europe at the moment. In the last general election, Labour had a lead amongst everybody under the age of 44. But that wasn't enough, clearly, to win, because older people are more likely to come out and vote, and they were so supportive of the Conservatives. So Labour need to have clear policies on pensions, on social care, on isolation and loneliness amongst older people, and they have to shout it from the rooftops, because unless we win over more older people, we're not going to win. Equally, younger people decisively support Labour, and younger people have been screwed over so much over the last few years that they're often not coming out to vote. So Labour need to have clear policies there and a clear strategy to mobilise more younger people as well. There's other issues. Self-employment. There's going to be more self-employed people than public sector workers in the next few years. Those self-employed people often like their independence. They don't like their insecurity. They don't get often social security, like paid sick leave, paid maternity leave. They often can't get loans from banks. They're chasing invoices from big companies. They have terrible infrastructure. You get, things like Deliveroo and elsewhere, the so-called gig economy, where you get people's rights and terms and conditions lowered. Labour need to have lots of things to say there, because, as I've said, there'll be more self-employed people than public sector workers. So in the moment, the danger is for Labour is we communicate in a way that only speaks to people who are politicised, who've joined the Labour Party, and they're very enthusiastic people. I think, my own parents are... they joined in the 1960s, and now they're completely re-energised. There's momentum, this grassroots organisation that came out of the Jeremy Corbyn campaign, and my mum runs the Edinburgh Momentum Facebook group. They're full of enthusiasm, and lots of people I know are full of that enthusiasm. The issue is how we communicate to people outside of that, and we haven't got that right yet, which I think there's an attempt to change, to turn that around. In terms of Jeremy Corbyn, he didn't expect to win. I've known him for many, many years. I used to work for John McDonnell, who's the shadow chancellor, his right-hand man. And Jeremy only stood out of a sense of duty. He didn't think he was going to win. And the argument at the time was we thought he'd come third. We thought that'd be a success. I mean, blimey. He said to me early on, Owen, if I get 20-25%, that'll be a success, won't it? I was like, yeah, Jeremy, of course it will. I didn't think he'd get... I was like, he's going to get 10%. Good luck with that. But the argument was we'd beat the Blairite candidate, Liz Kendall. That would be a success. And that campaign, it was like... It thought it was charging at a door that was made out of steel. But it was a door that was made out of paper. And it charged full blast. And it ended up in a situation it didn't expect to be in. And normally, if somebody becomes leader of the Labour Party, or any party, they have a big support from their own members of Parliament. They have years of ambition. They probably were doing speeches at the age of 12 in front of their own mirrors, pretending they were leaders. They have lots of experience with the media, lots of sympathetic journalists. They have this big professionalised team around them. None of that applied with Jeremy Corbyn, not one of them. It's a completely unique event in a Western democracy almost, where somebody who stood out of a sense of duty, was a no-hoper, ends up becoming leader. And the most experienced person in that situation would have found it very, very difficult. Somebody who was spent his life fighting for things that mainstream politics ignored and neglected, and he was vindicated, supporting the struggle against apartheid, opposing the arming of Saddam Hussein in the 1980s, and then opposing the Iraq War. supporting LGBT rights. All of those things were vindicated, but he was used to always fighting for things that were on the fringes, for the most vulnerable people, the most ignored people. And when you're leader of the opposition, you have to make an argument from a left-wing perspective, in our case, in the interest of the majority, that resonates with people who don't see themselves as left-wing. Because most people don't think about left or right-wing. They just think about issues to be addressed. And that is where lots of mistakes were made. And, first impressions are very important. Somebody didn't expect to win in that very difficult position with a hostile media. Our media is so aggressive, with a parliamentary Labour Party that didn't support him. So, if you don't define yourself, you get defined by your enemy. And there was an attempt, they responded in a very calm way when he was elected. The Conservatives said, Labour are now a threat to national security, economic security, and the security of your families. And we laugh here, and people laughed on social media. There were lots of memes and all the rest. But outside it does make a difference. And that's where Labour have to... it's never going to be easy. The press are always going to be against you. But you do need to have a message which you repeat over and over again that is clear and coherent, that reaches people who aren't political in the sense you are. And I haven't done that yet, and they haven't done that yet. And unless we do that quickly, the danger is of an authoritarian right-wing populism in Britain being very emboldened, with devastating consequences. A snap general election did look likely next year. It doesn't look like that's going to happen now. But nonetheless, we've got to get our act together. And that means having a clear, inspiring alternative that reaches people who desperately need hope, desperately want an alternative, are fed up with the way things are. And we need them to look at us and think, those people represent people like me. They speak for me. They have the answers for people like me. And we're not there yet, and that's what we've got to work on.
Owen und ich unterhalten uns jetzt ja schon eine gute Stunde. Ich möchte natürlich auch euch die Möglichkeit geben, ihm Fragen zu stellen. Vorher wollen aber Owen und ich noch ein Bier jeweils haben, weil wir haben beide unser ausgetrunken, oder? Ein Bier? Bier?
Yes.
Meine Kollegen, könnt ihr uns zwei Bier nach vorne reichen? Okay, ich habe mir das so überlegt, wir spielen sozusagen Ping-Pong. Ihr könnt eine Frage oder eine Anmerkung Owen stellen. Aber sie sollte nicht länger als 3 Minuten gehen, weil Owen spricht sehr lange und dann müsst ihr davon, das ist sozusagen, es geht von eurer Zeit dafür ab. Also bitte haltet euch kurz, ich würde einfach das Mikro so auf Vertrauen hier ins Publikum reichen und ich bitte wirklich darauf, 3 Minuten maximal.
Yeah, so I think the point about the relationship between Scotland and England is maybe more interesting than we've realised, because after a referendum in Scotland, which was by a long way a lot fairer and a lot more balanced in terms of the arguments that were made in comparison to what happened in the British referendum, we're still sitting here with the idea that there's a real possibility that despite the result of the referendum, that Scotland might leave the UK. And why is it that the people who make up the structure of the left in England, including yourself, Mr. Jones, why is there such a blind acceptance that England now has to leave the EU, despite the fact that that is not a legally binding referendum, despite the fact that, like you said, the whole debate was conducted despicably, was charged by a lot of racist rhetoric and a lot of misinformation. And why is that being so blindly accepted? And why is where, like you said, we have to ask on the left very difficult questions. And what are those, because you're part of that, so what are the questions that you're actually asking yourself? What do you mean by we have to get our act together? Like, one of those questions I would put to you is, where are another Europe is possible? Where is it now?
Look, I think leaving the European Union, that referendum result is the biggest disaster to befall Britain since the end of the war. And it was a calamity which we're suffering the consequences of today. And you know how things are back home. And I've never been so frightened about the future of my own country. I can't empathise with you more. But the reality is, with that referendum, is we lost it. And yes, we lost against a vicious campaign of racism and bigotry, which exploited the worst prejudices. It was full of lies. They came up with this figure, we're going to get £350 million a week extra for the NHS, completely made up, none of it true, none of it based on reality. But often lots of elections are lost against people who lie and incite prejudice and bigotry. And as much as we want to overturn all of those results, that's just not how it works. And if it had been the other way round, if we'd won 52 to 48% of the vote, and they argued that we need to have another referendum in 5 years, we just wouldn't have even indulged that argument. And the problem with the argument, and this is where it becomes so problematic, is under our electoral system, which I oppose, we have a ridiculous electoral system in Britain called First Past the Post. So even though the referendum result was very close, 52 to 48%, under our electoral system, if you rerun that referendum, Leave would win 420 seats against 229 for Remain. Because Remain piled up all of their votes in London, Manchester, Birmingham, Scotland, and that was about it. And so if you run a referendum, if a party argues to overturn the referendum result, they'd be obliterated, they'd lose. And the polling shows amongst people who voted Remain that most of them want the referendum result to be respected. So even amongst Remain voters, it wouldn't work. If it is the case over the next few years that it is a disaster, Brexit, and you get so-called buyer's remorse, where lots of people who voted to leave change their minds, then we can reopen that discussion. But my fear is this. Right-wing populism intentionally is trying to portray us as the elite. It's trying to portray us as people wanting to subvert democratic decisions. We hate working-class people who voted disproportionately to leave. And I worry we play into their hands if we say we don't like the referendum. We imply people who voted for it were dupes or just stupid. And you're not saying that, but that's how it will come across to people, that you were brainwashed and that you're stupid enough to believe lies. And it will be so counterproductive. That's exactly what Nigel Farage and the hardcore Brexiteers want us to do. So my own view is that we have to argue for a Brexit that puts jobs, living standards, the economy first. Otherwise, what will happen is the populist, xenophobic and neoliberal right, using a clunky term, that they will take control of the entire debate on Brexit. They will leave us on the fringes as people moaning about a referendum result we're terribly upset about, and it will just allow them to ensure we have the worst possible terms possible. So my own view is now we argue for an exit on the best possible terms. Yes, if people change their minds in the next few years, we'll reopen this debate. But it is politically impossible to argue to overturn that referendum. And I feel your hurt. I empathise with that. I feel exactly the same anger and frustration that you do. But I just don't think it's possible in the slightest to argue for overturning that referendum. And we've got to make sure we get our act together to make sure we never lose against such a campaign of poison and lies ever again.
Hi, thanks. Going back, I suppose, to Labour Party strategy. At the moment, obviously, when we've got paused, when we've got such a situation of, you know, the alternative to leftist politics and, you know, the Trumps, the Le Pens being so sort of abhorrent, my sense is perhaps that the left needs to count its allies in a slightly larger circle rather than a sort of smaller one. Given that, you know, you wrote recently about Sack Goldsmith's by-election, Labour chose to... it was great. Labour chose to run a candidate in Richmond Park. Absolutely fine. Obviously, it worked out perfectly well. I suppose what I'm asking you is there a... do you think Labour need to be a little less purist about, given that we have first past the post, given that, I mean, I come from the West Country, Labour are not going to win there unless you've got an Exeter and a Ben Bradshaw, who actually is sort of definitely in the sort of more on the Blairite wing of Labour politics. I mean, do we need to be a little less purist, a little less tribal, and actually count our circles a little wider there and be a bit more strategic in that way?
It's a really good point. Zach Goldsmith, for those who don't know, he stood for the London mayoralty in May on inciting, you know, it was based, the candidate against him, Sadiq Khan, was a Muslim, and his whole campaign was this disgusting, anti-Muslim, bigoted campaign, and the good people of London turned around when they saw that campaign and said, no, get out of our city, and he lost calamitously. And then he stood again, this time he's an MP. He resigned his seat for vain reasons, and he lost again. So the only good things to have happened in Britain in the last year involves Zach Goldsmith. So I'm very grateful to Zach Goldsmith. But there you go. In terms of what happened there, so the area, Richmond in London, Labour are nowhere there. It's one of the richest constituencies in the whole of the country. And he was defeated, the Conservative candidate, obviously, by a Liberal Democrat. Labour stood a candidate, and they got a derisory vote. Yeah, I mean, it's difficult, that one. I totally agree. Empathise with you, by the way. In certain constituencies, Labour can't win. In lots of the southwest, they don't win. I think in lots of those places, they're actually quite poor. Labour should be doing well, but they failed for lots of historic reasons. It's about how we get that right, because people are very angry with the Lib Dems in Britain because they propped up the Conservative government, which did terrible things like privatising the NHS, instituting terrible cuts, policies which hurt disabled people, and so on. So they look and they reneged on their key pledges. In the general election, they said they would abolish tuition fees. They voted to treble them, and so on. So people don't trust them, quite clearly. People, you shout Labour, you're quite right, in terms of the Iraq war and so on. But the difference is, under Labour, there's lots of things I opposed New Labour for, and I marched against New Labour over and over again. But at least we got a minimum wage, at least we got LGBT rights, at least we got investment in public services. We got lots of things that the government are now getting rid of that we've protested to try and save. Under the Conservative government, the only good thing we got was equal marriage, which didn't quite make up, I have to say, for all the other things they did. So there was a difference there between good and terrible things and just terrible things altogether. And the Lib Dems propped that up. However, and this is an important, and this is the other problem as well, to defeat the right, that means having a genuinely inspiring alternative. If an alliance means we have to water that down, then we won't win, because it has to be a genuinely compelling alternative. If it looks like an establishment stitch-up where we're not offering a real, credible alternative, then I'm not so sure we're going to win. But in Richmond and in large parts of the country, we're never going to win Labour. It's just not realistic under our electoral system. I want a new electoral system, proportional representation. We won't get that without a Labour-led government backed up realistically by other parties as well. So I think Labour has to ask, and we're talking about what hard searching questions we have to ask. I'm very open, and I signed a letter for Richmond saying Labour shouldn't stand a candidate. And as a quid pro quo, we should have asked the Lib Dems that the next time there's a seat where Labour is the best place to win, you shouldn't stand a candidate either. That's painful for people of my politics. It's difficult and it's hard because I'm still angry with the Liberal Democrats and I'm not interested in boosting or reviving them, and I don't see them as a progressive party. But if we're going to get a government that can change the electoral system and get rid of the Conservatives, then that might mean Labour not standing candidates in places they can't ever win and have never won in ever in the history of British democracy as a quid pro quo. But that is difficult and hard, and it's a discussion we need to have. So I totally empathise with you.
Thank you. Oh, sorry. Hello. I'm here because I'm familiar with your work, and I wanted to come here tonight to find out where to turn next. It seems to me Labour has a history of standing up against the aggressor, which is beautiful. But I think we're at a point now where we feel the aggressor has powers that we cannot touch. So I'm here to find out where to turn next to redefine what Labour is standing for. And I feel
sometimes when you talk about Labour being very based in the working class and you use words like crisis, that you're generating that same vocabulary that people are becoming vague about. So who else is thinking about these themes? We're very used to the word think tank, a neoliberal think tank. Is there a Labour, is there a leftist think tank that I can be following and adding my voice to?
It's a very important point. I think there's two think tanks in Britain which are trying to ask these sorts of questions. One is called the New Economics Foundation, which do some very good and compelling work. The other is called CLASS, which is set up by various trade unions. But, I mean, part of what you're saying is communication, and that is something I'm myself asking lots of questions about. So at the last general election, during the leaders' debates, where the leaders of the main parties debated on television, the most commonly Googled phrase in Britain was, what is austerity? After 5 years of it, because it's an abstraction to most people. And you get the Conservatives, what they do, George Osborne, do you remember him? No, but they used to say that a deficit was like a household budget, which is economically illiterate unless any of you have a central bank printing money in your back garden, which strikes me as unlikely. And also in your household, presumably if your income gets cut, that doesn't cut the income of your brother or sister. So it makes no sense whatsoever. But I've just gone back to the when you're explaining your losing point that I said before. They framed it that way and people went, oh yeah, if I'm in debt, I don't spend more money, I cut back on my spending. You've won the argument, haven't you? I mean, that's what they did over and over again. And the left didn't have that same way of communicating. We often use abstractions. You know, there's a political linguist called George Lakoff, and he says that the right often use stories, the left use facts and statistics. But we're not robots or machines, we're human beings. We talk and we think in terms of emotions and other lived experiences. So, you know, in Britain, a big debate, so-called, is about benefit fraud. So that's people illegally claiming social security that they shouldn't be having. And you'll get the front pages of newspapers saying, here's someone with 50 kids living in a mansion made out of widescreen television sets. It's always widescreen television sets. You can't actually buy any of your form of television anymore, but I'll park that. But then you get smart asses like me go, well, benefit fraud is only 0.7% of spending. But that doesn't work. You've got to speak in the language of human experience. So another example, I often use the story of a 60-year-old man called Stephen Taylor, an army veteran. And this army veteran was out of work. If you're 60 years old and out of work, it's hard. But he's trying his best, looking for work. And he was looking for work. And at the same time, he volunteered for a charity, the Royal Legion, which looks after injured former soldiers. And he was selling poppies to raise money for injured former comrades of his. And he was selling these poppies in a supermarket where he applied for work but was unsuccessful. He had his social security stopped for 4 weeks on the basis his volunteering for that charity showed he wasn't trying hard enough to look for work. Now, that is far more powerful than saying in the last 18 months, 1 million people have had their benefits stopped. But that's how we often communicate. The right don't do that. They talk about stories. So yes, we need research, but the left has lots of research. But we often don't put it in a language that people can understand, that's emotional, that connects with people's experiences. And the people we're up against do that far, far better than us. So yeah, I agree, we need those think tanks, and I've come up with two there, but we need to communicate in a far more powerful way. Because Donald Trump, you know, we ridiculed it, didn't we? Make America great again. But it's an ingenious slogan. It was better together. Oh, no, stronger together. Hillary Clinton, stronger together. In Britain, Brexit's big slogan was take back control. That is ingenious. I go around Britain interviewing people and they repeat take back control verbatim. I can't even remember the Remain slogan. And so I think we need to work on how we communicate. And that is partly, in terms of those think tanks, I think we should have as much research going into alternatives as to how we explain those alternatives. Because often the left thinks, just tell the facts, tell the truth, and people will come to us. And it doesn't work. You've got to win them here as well as win them here. And the right are winning here and not here. And that's why we're losing.
Cheers. You've actually just half answered my question. I was going to ask about the art of rhetoric and whether you thought the left basically has a rhetoric problem, which you've just addressed. But the flip side to that, a lot of people talk in the current era that we're descending into an era of personality politics, which is a model which was made famous by the American model, which has essentially descended into populist TV farce. And so you see a lot of people investing their hopes these days in people and in icons instead of particular parties. And in to some respect, you see that in an icon like Jeremy Corbyn, who people have invested a lot of hope in him as, I guess, some kind of more populist left-wing vision of a party that they felt had abandoned them. But my question is, if with so many people investing so much faith in single people, do you think that opens up a risky liability that if they then prove impotent or unable to fulfill the hopes and wishes of the people who have put so much faith in them, they risk collapsing the entire movement that has gone along with them? And where do you see the balance between investing in people and investing in a movement, and where should the weight lie?
Really, really good point. Really good point. Firstly, by the way, it's so good so many women have spoken first today, by the way, because normally I've been to events where this would be as long as it would take to get. So it's as one token man to another. No, it's great to see, though. Such a good point, such an important point. I think instinctively I always argued, you know, someone who had a big impact on me was Tony Benn, a British socialist, who'd always say that it's the policies, not the personalities. Can't do a Republican impression of him. But he'd always say that it's the policies, not personalities. And it should be, but in practice it isn't. And I think often, again, the purest approach on the left would be, well, what should matter above all else is you just need a collective movement and it doesn't matter who the spokesperson is. But it obviously does matter to a degree that you have somebody who can inspire, who it's things like having a backstory. Should a backstory matter? No, but it does help. And, you know, I think, so somebody who at the moment is a friend of mine, so I'm biased, he's Clive Lewis. He's the shadow business secretary under Jeremy Corbyn. He backed Jeremy Corbyn twice. He's a former soldier. He's not a London MP. He grew up on a council estate in the Midlands. Should that matter? No, but it kind of does to a lot of people, because people often, they want to be able to emotionally connect with somebody. And it does matter the sort of leader that you have, that they have a backstory that resonates. I mean, that's not always the case. I mean, take, you know, Clement Attlee, who was the post-war Labour Prime Minister, whose government founded the National Health Service and the welfare state. He was from a posh background. He went to public school. So it's not, obviously, I'm not saying you need, you know, it's not a completely necessary. But in the world in which we're in currently, personality obviously matters more than it used to, and we're moving more towards a presidential system. Do I like that? No. But sometimes it feels a bit like on the left, we sort of bark at thunder. We just kind of were angry at the way things are, and we kind of rebel against it rather than saying, well, look, we've got to exploit this as best we can if we want to win. And that does mean having leaders to a degree that people can connect with. But as you've said, the danger of that is if you throw everything at one leader, if it becomes dependent on one leader, if you basically have a cult of personality, which is problematic for lots of different reasons, then if they fail, then everything comes crashing down with them. So you need to have, I mean, I look at Podemos in Spain as quite a good model, actually, because they're a movement that came out of this, of other movements, of the anti-eviction movements and so on. And their allies are, you know, Ada Colau in Barcelona, who she's one of the most inspiring politicians I've ever met. She came out of the anti-eviction movement, which she helped to lead. In, you know, she's not a member, but she's an ally. Similarly in Madrid, Manuel Carmena, who was a lawyer who fought for the rights of political dissidents under Franco. Again, she's not a member, but she's an ally. And then you've got Pablo Iglesias, but you've got lots of other people within Podemos. So yes, you've got this big leader, and he came to prominence in Spain because he went on TV and debated on TV shows. So, you know, his personal not brand, I hate using that word. His personality obviously did have an impact, and people found it attractive a certain layer, and it was helpful, but they've balanced that out by having lots of other figures as well. So I think that's the way of doing it. Yes, have an inspiring leader, but they have to be accountable to a movement. They can't replace the movement, and you've got to have lots of other people as well. And there is a danger, the left sometimes has this tendency to often rely on demagogic, privileged men of a certain type whose ego becomes a problem, and their ego becomes more important than the cause. And I'm not going to name people, but there's a long history of that, and that's not helped our movement at all. So yes, definitely get good leaders who are inspiring, who have good backstories, but that's no substitute for a movement, and it should always... We are a collective struggle, after all. That's the whole point of being on the left, that the power of people uniting together can overcome injustice. So that doesn't mean you just throw everything at one leader. So it's about balancing it out. Good leaders who are inspiring and can resonate with people, and a strong grassroots movement that can go out and win people over as well. And sometimes we get it wrong on both sides.
I just wanted to check that you understood something that you said before. You mentioned something about the metropolitan left being disconnected from the working class or the rest of the working class. Maybe I misunderstood it, but if that is indeed what you're saying, how do you suggest that metropolitan left does reconnect with people? Because I think most of the people in this room are probably the metropolitan left, academics or whatever. What can we do to bring that back to where it should be?
Where are you from, by the way? That's a northern accent of some
Manchester.
Sort.
Manchester.
Oh, Manchester, I thought so. Way to Manchester. A lot of Manx. I don't know if I said metropolitan left, but nonetheless, I understand exactly what you mean. No, it's not either or, because, look, more and more people have gone to university now, including, you know, people... You get... Look, the social democratic or the left of centre coalitions across Europe often are young university-educated people who live in big cities, and then older working-class people who often live in small towns. And you need to build a coalition that brings them all together. It's not one or the other. Because, you know, you get now lots of young people who go to university. In my country and other countries, not this country, you end up with huge amounts of debt for doing so. And you often end up with quite low-paid, precarious jobs at the end of it. So this idea of saying anyone who goes... Which you're not saying, but the idea of anyone who goes to university is this out-of-touch, privileged elitist just isn't true. And all over Europe now, that group of people, university-educated people, has become an ever-important, you know, part of society. Lots of people who support Podemos... You know, Podemos is led by political scientists, basically, at universities... But lots of the people who support it are university-educated young people who are often now baristas at the end of it. So I do think, you know, there's this false dichotomy that sometimes we come up with, which is either, you know, it's just about, you know, kind of young people in big cities who went to university, or it's older working-class people who didn't go to university in smaller towns. And it's about how you bring those two groups together. And that is hard. Because, for example, attitudes to immigration with those two groups are often very, very different. Younger people who went to university in big cities often are more supportive of immigration. People in smaller towns often, generalising, it's just what the evidence shows, are more likely to be opposed to immigration. But also the way people speak, the way people look at the world, the way people express their values are often very different. But that tent has to be big enough to bring them both together. So for me, it's about balancing it out. We need to have, you know, I want, you know, there's always a place, there has to be a place in left politics for metropolitan leftists, because they're a big chunk of people who support the left, and they're ever more important. The danger is a lack of working class political representation, full stop. And in the British Parliament, every general election, there's fewer and fewer working class people with a voice. And the part of that has meant that many people who traditionally supported the Labour Party, they look at Labour and think, this no longer speaks for people like me. It doesn't speak in a language I understand. And the danger is, because what the populist right argue is, these people hate you. They don't like you. They don't like your values. They're condescending. And if we allow that to take root, then we're finished. And after Brexit, what worried me is some people played into that, because you got these people in big cities who voted to remain, who basically said these thick, uneducated people who were brainwashed by Leave, and that kind of argument is exactly what the populist right want us to do. So the left does need to have more working class people in its ranks at a senior level. And by working class, by the way, because the danger is now people think that just means... when you say working class, sometimes it sometimes seems to mean white, middle-aged men. And working class people means women, who constitute the majority of society, and black and minority ethnic working class people as well. So what we need is, we need women who work in supermarkets to be... you know, their voices heard. The women who work part-time whilst looking after their kids in Newcastle or in a smaller town in Germany, for example. So we do need to be clear what we mean about the working class, but the danger is the left can be too skewed in favour of just one part of the coalition, young, educated people who speak in a way that only they often understand, but is very alienating for other working class people in smaller towns who just don't look at the world in the same way. So we've got to find a way of having a left that can bring them both together, that they both have leadership roles, that they both have a role in shaping left strategy and priorities. If we don't do that, then the populist right will simply say, the left has abandoned the working class, they hate you, they don't like your values, and then we will never win again. So we have to get that balance right.
So my question is, you wrote an article about gerrymandering, I think in September, and I read a book called Dark Money by Jane Mayer, which kind of talks about how like the billionaires in America have basically influenced public opinion over the last 40 years. And they've used a lot of sneaky tactics that, like, after the Obama administration came in, the administration weren't even aware of them doing, but then led them to having control of the Congress and then the Senate, and also made Trump's election now very possible, in my opinion. And my question is kind of, if those things are happening in the UK, which from your article it seems that they are, and if the left are aware of the right being very sneaky and underhanded in that way, and like in place to stop it happening, if you see what I mean.
Really, really, really good point. Look, I mean, in America, the Republicans have only won the popular vote in the presidency once since 1992. And it's quite an astonishing fact, that, because they lost in 2000 but won the presidency. And they lost, obviously, again this year, but still managed to... They lost not just the presidency, but they lost in Congress as well, but they still managed to win a majority of seats. In Britain, for those who don't know, there's lots of devices being used now to stitch up the electoral system in favour of the Conservatives. So in the last general election, there used to be, actually, because of the shift in population, it was traditionally said that for the last 10 years, there's been a bias towards Labour. But the last general election, that ended, and the Tories needed far fewer votes to win a seat than Labour did. But now what the Tories are trying to do is change the electoral boundaries in Britain. So what that means is people have to register to vote, and it used to be the case that parents, universities could automatically register students or their children. You can't do that anymore. You have to register yourself. Younger people tend to move about, so that means often they move addresses, they don't register at their new address, and they're not on the electoral register. So the people less likely to be on the electoral register are younger people, private renters, black and minority ethnic people, basically any group in British society that is least likely to vote for the Conservatives. But they're now drawing up constituencies on the basis of that electoral register. And that will shift the electoral map even further towards the Conservatives than it already is. At the same time, things like they've introduced legislation on trade unions to try and cripple the financial support that Labour relies on. They've tried to reduce the amount of money that opposition parties get from the state, for example. So they've done lots of different things to try and stitch up the electoral map. In America, similarly, what they've done is, we know obviously in terms of the disproportionate incarceration of African Americans and certain states which forbid criminals, people with convictions from being able to vote. That played a big role in 2000, of course. But we've seen other changes to electoral law in various American states that has disproportionately disenfranchised potential Democratic voters, and people were turned away at polling stations as well. So there is an obvious attempt by the right, in Britain and the United States in particular, to disenfranchise voters who are least likely to vote for them. And we've got to get aggressive about this. It's a threat to our democracy. Our democracy wasn't given to us. You know, it wasn't like the powerful wake up one day and think, oh, I'm feeling generous, I'll give women the vote for a laugh. People had to fight at great cost and great sacrifice, whether it be, you know, the early trade unionists who fought for the rights of workers, whether it be in Britain, we had the Chartists in the 19th century, which fought for the rights of working men to have a vote, that every constituency should be equal. Whether it be the suffragettes, I mean, now everyone loves the suffragettes now. They have Hollywood films made about them. In their time, they were reviled, they were hated, they were anarchists, they were terrorists, they were dragged from demonstrations, thrown into dirty prison cells with tubes forced down their noses. All of our democratic rights were won by our ancestors at great cost. My fear is now that democratic freedoms that our ancestors fought for are being repealed and eroded with barely a murmur of protest. And we owe it to our ancestors who fought for our democracy to stand up for the rights and freedoms they fought for. We can't allow the Republicans and the Conservatives in Britain to gerrymander our electoral system to ensure they have a permanent inbuilt bias, when in the case of Britain, they already have the entire mainstream press practically on their side as it is. All the odds are stacked in their favour, but that's not how democracy should work. And just finally on that, I went to Hungary the other week. Hungary is a member of the European Union, where they've clamped down on the freedom of the press. It is indeed becoming a dictatorship. And my theory is, across the Western world, there is a shift towards authoritarianism, where you have so-called managed democracies, where you keep the trappings of democracy. You know, you still have elections and different parties, but all the odds are so stacked in favour of one party, in terms of how the electoral rules work, in terms of the press, that it is no longer democracy in any meaningful sense. And we can see that happening in Hungary and in Poland, but we can already see that creeping in other countries as well. And if we allow that to happen, that is an insult to our ancestors who fought for our democratic freedoms at such cost.
Hello. Just keep it brief. Following the US election, I became terrified of fake news. Is this justified?
Fake news. All I say is, with fake news, is there's nothing new about fake news. The Hillsborough disaster. In 1989, 96 Liverpool fans were crushed to death because of the actions of the British police. And the British press, the Sun in particular, lied and smeared those fans and blamed them for their own deaths in alliance with the police. That was fake news. Of course it was. In 1984 in Britain, we had the miners' strike, where miners were, you know, there was at Orgreave, there was an infamous incident between the police and the striking miners. And according to Liberty, our civil rights movement, they said it was a police riot. The police charged at the miners and attacked them and tried to stitch them up and all the rest. And the BBC put the tape of what happened in a different order to make it look like the miners had attacked the police. That was fake news as well. And my fear is, there is a problem with fake news. Partly, you know, you get now the stranglehold of the mainstream media has been weakened. And the danger with that is you get politicised groups who are able to spread information far more freely. A lot of it is just wrong and false and inciting fear and playing to people's prejudices. And that played obviously a role in Donald Trump's election. So we should be worried about it, and it should be taken on and confronted. So I agree with that. My frustration is, it does let the mainstream media off the hook, because for many years, the mainstream media have spread false news about immigrants, about unemployment in Britain. People think teenage pregnancy is 20 times higher than it actually is. They think benefit fraud is 20 times higher as well than it actually is. They think there are far more immigrants than there are. Why? Partly the media spreading myths and lies. I don't think it's all the media's fault. I don't think people are just brainwashed, as I've said before. People like me often use the media as an excuse not to address our own failings. Oh, we haven't failed to persuade people. No, 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 it's all the media's fault. I agree we can't do that, but there is a big problem with the media for many years, obviously spreading myths, not telling the truth, very high-profile examples of it, and not enough anger about it. And now you get some people doing these stupid blogs that go viral, which are false, and all of a sudden there's massive anger about it. So we need balance. Let's take on the false news that is spread by these blogs that Facebook and the rest disseminate, but we should also be far more aggressive in challenging a mainstream press, which is all too often willing to demonise and stigmatise immigrants and Muslims and unemployed people based on false news. So we should be more balanced about it, but I agree with you.
So we've spoken a bit about the like tension between the political figure, so like the leader, the personality and the policies. And we're in a situation now with Jeremy Corbyn being the twice very successfully elected leader. And in between those two elections, you had what can really be called like a political coup almost in the Labour Party, with the shadow cabinet basically almost most of it resigning to try and get him out. And that didn't work. And the media is against him. And you said that the right uses stories and communicates better. And I completely agree that that's one of the, if not the biggest issue the Labour Party has, is communication. But Jeremy Corbyn uses stories like that, I think, more than anyone else, a politician. Like he goes, oh, last week I spoke to Tom from Liverpool who told me this. And he does that all the time. And I feel that, like, I get the feeling that he's one of these people who there is so much hope and he's achieved so much and he represents a lot of possibility, but the odds really seem stacked against him because despite the two elections, despite surviving the resignations, despite the mainstream media being totally against him, there's still this, like, hesitation. And I find it difficult to believe the rhetoric that comes from the media, which is, he's failing to unite the Labour Party. Is he failing to unite the Labour Party, or is the Labour Party failing to unite behind him? And my question is, what should the people who are in power now in the Labour Party, so not the movement, not the people who join it, not us really, but what should the people who are elected, who are MPs, what should they be doing to move Labour on in the next year or two, looking forward?
Very good point. And look, I think... Brexit, as I've said, was the biggest crisis we'd had since the end of World War II, and it was unforgivable to use that time for the Labour Party to implode on itself, have this completely pointless waste of time, this introspective internal schism at a time when all the focus should have been on the Conservatives. Look, things got so bad in politics in Britain that the day the Prime Minister resigned, that was third on the news. I mean, it was astonishing. It was a time of crisis and all the focus should have been on the Conservatives and the trauma they were going through. But you had this implosion of the Labour Party at a time of national crisis. So it was just an absurd thing to have happened. My view is there were three elements of the Labour Party and all three have a responsibility. The Parliamentary Labour Party to accept the democratic verdict. The leadership to have a clear strategy to win and to win people over outside the immediate bubble, and the activists, not just to join to vote, but to go out into their communities, knock on doors, and reach people. And I think all three elements have far more to do. And that's just my own view, because things have settled down in the Labour Party, by the way, in the last few months. There's no question the polling Labour has at the moment is very bad. And when I often talk about polling, people go, well, polling's often wrong. Polling is rarely wrong in a way that benefits the left. So in 1992 and 2015, those are the two infamous polling disasters that happened, where the polling was just wrong. And in both times, it's because Labour were overestimated in the polling. So when I look at polling, I take it seriously. And the polling is bad, not just the headline polling, but the underlying polling. So we can argue about why we've ended up there. I think the Parliamentary Labour Party have had a role. I think the leadership, who I've known for years, and these are people I've literally, they're close friends of mine, some of them, So I'm not attacking them or criticizing them. They didn't expect to be in that position, so obvious mistakes were going to be made. The left is not used to being in a position of power or influence, so it's inevitably going to happen. And Britain happens to have a very aggressive press. You need a very sophisticated strategy to deal with it. And they've had to learn in public. And that's hard and difficult. And it means making often, you know, the initial impression wasn't good. It was very chaotic and turbulent. Inevitably, that was going to happen. But we do need to turn it around, because the danger is, for me, that if Labour lost an election, as things stand badly, the left will be blamed and we'll end up with a very populist, authoritarian-led Conservative Party sweeping across the country with devastating consequences for the future. So my own view is the PLP need to stop these self-indulgent bickering and undermining. I totally agree with that. The Labour leadership need to show they have an obvious, clear strategy. How we're going to win? How are we going to win people over who aren't convinced at the moment? How are we going to change people's minds? For whatever reason, whatever the reasons they have that they don't support us at the moment, how are we going to win over those older voters who keep delivering victories for the Conservative Party? How are we going to mobilise more younger people? How are we going to win over that growing number of self-employed people? How are we going to have a clear message we repeat over and over again? Because that's what the Conservatives do. They have a message, they stick to it. We're clearing up Labour's mess, we're balancing the books, long-term economic plan, all the rest. What are our clear messages that we're going to say over and over again until our opponents are tearing their hair out? You know, and the activists, the members even, not the activists, 600,000 members. If every single one of those members knocked on 10 doors, that's 6 million homes. And if every home has 4 people in it, that's 24 million people. It's half the population almost of Britain. But that's not happening at the moment. And that needs a strategy in place, because that is huge potential. If you've got so many people who've joined a political party, think about what we could do, the organising in communities, the reaching people at the moment who at the moment, you know, they're getting a bad impression from the media. But if you have a one-on-one conversation or you do something locally in the community as a party, you could win them over. So in my own view, leadership, parliamentary Labour Party, members, every single one of them has a responsibility and a duty. Because if we get this wrong now, we're going to suffer the consequences. But this is a time of potential. It's either us at the moment, or it's the populist right. And I want us to succeed, but everybody has a role to play in that. We've all got to get it right.
Following on from the blueprint you've just outlined, how likely is that to happen in the next 4 years? And have you ever considered standing for election yourself?
Things are desperate, but they're not that desperate. Look, my own view on stuff like this, it just has to happen. And you know, it's easy often when we look at these obstacles to say they are so big, they are so immense, that it's so intimidating, you know, to even begin, you know, to debate what we do about them. But my own view is the stakes are so high. What we've been up against for the last few years is a Conservative Party ideologically committed to cuts. But we're up against something far worse now, which is authoritarian, xenophobic populism in Britain, in the United States, and all over Europe. So if we get it wrong, it was already bad enough when we got it wrong last time. Losing the general election last year was a disaster. It was a disaster for the people who Labour exists to represent and champion. But it is far worse now when you have a country in such a crisis with an opposition now which is far worse than anything we've been up against for a very long time. And you have the media attacking people as enemies of the people if they're dissenters. When you've just had a Labour MP murdered by a far-right terrorist. This is a very dangerous period. We've got to get this right. So my own view is, it's not a question of the Owen, look, I'm not saying you're saying this, but others would go, this is just not realistic. Some will say the Parliamentary Labour Party will never accept it. They'll keep undermining. What is the point? Others will go, the leadership are completely incompetent, a waste of space. They can't communicate. They can't reach outside their bubble. Others will say members are they're never going to knock on doors. And I just think, what a waste of time. If you think that, just shut up. I mean, it's just irrelevant. I mean, not you, I mean, obviously. Not insulting questioners. But the people, that council of despair often I found on the left, which is where It's one thing to understand what we're up against, and I accept that, but sometimes the tendency on the left, I fall into this sometimes myself, is to say that it's to wallow in our own defeats, it's to wallow in our own terrible plight. But my own view is you've got to assess where things are. So often I've said things which people on the left find very aggravating. They say they're unhelpful, you're just feeding our enemies, you should just be uncritically supportive of the Labour leadership. I don't think that's the right thing to do. If you want the Labour leadership to succeed, that sometimes means saying things people don't want you to say. But at the same time, it doesn't mean saying things are so bad and terrible that you don't have a strategy to come up to deal with it. So we've got to have a strategy. That means a really big debate and discussion about what we can do. And whenever I travel all over Britain at the moment, and one of the things I argue all the time is if you've turned up to this talk, if you've turned up to, you've not, it's not, presumably not just to listen to me babble, but you've come because you want to change things. You want to challenge the way things are. And that doesn't mean just turning up to things like this full of like-minded people, generally speaking, to just let off a bit of steam. We turn up here because we want to change things. And that means, how do we reach all those people who aren't convinced at the moment? And that is always our starting point. So for my own view is, we're up against huge odds that given those, the stakes are so high at the moment, given what we've seen in America, how close things were in Austria, what things were up against, what we're seeing in France in the coming months, in the Netherlands, the rise of the AfD here in Germany. We've got to get this right. And that means not wallowing in defeat and pessimism. It means saying, this is what we're up against, and this is a strategy to overcome it, because we've done this before. Things were far worse in the 1930s. It's worth talking about that, isn't it? What is the strategy? Blimey. What is the strategy for the European left? How long have we got left now? Not that long, presumably. Look, my own view, I mean, on that, I mean, obviously we're talking in terms of country by country, but what I think in Spain, Podemos have only been around for a few years, but one of the things they've done so well is to communicate to people who don't normally see themselves as on the left. Spain is one of the only countries in Europe that doesn't have a populist right-wing movement. And a lot of people who now support Podemos may well have succumbed to the sort of right-wing xenophobic demagoguery that a lot of that as we've seen across Europe. But they've communicated in a way that reaches beyond just people who are on the left. And it is a lot to do with communication. It's about how you speak in a way that reaches beyond those who are already convinced and excited and radicalized. What do you say about older people who, you know, at the moment feel very alienated from the left across Europe? If we won over more older people in Europe, we'd be winning far more elections. It means, what do we say about self-employed people? It means, what do we say in terms of how do we communicate investing in the economy rather than cutting back in a way that people can understand? And that's where we failed at the moment. And it means also, how do we reach, how do we, all these people, there are lots of people in Europe who are scared and angry and fearful, but we've not got them to go in their own communities and do things. Now, in Greece, however things panned out with Syriza, what that movement did wasn't just turn up to rallies and protests. They did things like, they set up food banks where they organised the people who came to the food banks. They set up youth community centres. So what that meant is, you know, with youth services being cut away, they filled the vacuum. They got, you know, they gave something for young people to do, but they also got these young people drawn into politics because of it. They showed they were part of the community. They did things in their local communities that made people think, well, these people, I'm not on the left. I don't see myself as a leftist. But because they're helping people like me, maybe, just maybe, they are the future of my country. And that's what happened there. And that's what's happened partly with Podemos as well. So I think it's about communication. It's about organising in our community. In a way that we're just not doing at the moment. And we've got to get that right, because often the far right do that far better than us. Have you told Jeremy Corbyn that? Have I told Jeremy Corbyn that? You tell Jeremy. Why do I have to tell him?
Yeah, thank you very much. I want to address the question of what it means to be English, if it means anything at all now. How do we even get to the level where someone like myself can travel around in Europe and be accepted as being English, and not just in Europe, but much, you know, not less in England itself, in Britain? How can we get to that state? I think that is probably the issue. I mean, looking around this room, and I'm probably one of the few coloured people. How do we reach out to these people that you talk about, these disenfranchised voters, so that they feel co-opted in this movement? And I mean, I'm not saying that you're middle class, but you know, we need people, more people that are representative of this if we want to see the change, this in the left being more of a force. How can we co-opt it? Is this more of a long-term thing? Because actually, it's...
So what do you mean in terms of, so obviously in terms of what is Englishness, but how do we win over, be more inclusive in terms of minorities, for example, who...
Yeah, how can they be accepted as being English? I mean, that's not just a question within England itself, because I travel around everywhere around in Europe, and just, you know, people are very habitualized into judgments based on appearances, and I think that is actually quite a major crux of why we are where we are politically across Europe. How do we address this? How can we change this to be more inclusive?
It's a really good point. Is that the last question? Oh, just so I know, because I'm going to wrap up as well. In terms of Englishness, and so, because you're right, because it's not just about Englishness, it's about identity all over Europe at the moment. I think this is something, again, I keep referring to Podemos. The reason I keep referring to Podemos is, of any major European country, that's where the left of a kind of radical stripe are doing best at the moment. So it is worth learning from them about where they're going right. And one of the things they've tried to do is redefine patriotism. In England in particular, that's something the left are very, very uncomfortable with indeed. They see patriotism as a byword for chauvinism, racism, and imperialism. And often English nationalism has been wrapped up with all of those things. It's been very, you know, in Scotland, for example, their form of nationalism is civic nationalism. So the Scottish National Party have more BME politicians than any other party, for example, as a percentage. Obviously, they dominate Scottish politics now, but as a percentage. So, you know, they've had this inclusive form of civic nationalism. Some would say that's because Scotland historically is an oppressed country, but Scotland was up to its neck in empire. People don't like to talk about that, but it was a Scottish and English endeavour, the British Empire. So it is problematic, patriotism, because it can mean chauvinism, and all the rest. And if you're on the left, you believe in internationalism. You believe that the problems you face are problems shared by people regardless of borders. The people you're up against don't know borders. You can't either. You can't solve the problems you have one country at a time. But, and it is a but, I do think we need to redefine patriotism in the way Podemos have done. So, you know, what is patriotic about forcing the majority to pay for a crisis they had absolutely nothing to do with? What is patriotic about doing down proud institutions like the National Health Service? What is patriotic about driving hundreds of thousands of people in one of the richest countries on earth to charities, to food banks, in order to feed themselves, to satisfy the most basic human need of all, other than breathing and drinking water, to eat, 300,000 of them kids? You know, what is more patriotic than defending the rights and freedoms our ancestors fought for at such cost and such sacrifice? What is more patriotic than defending great institutions like the NHS? What is more patriotic than fighting for a society that is not rigged as a playground for a tiny elite, but is running the interests of the majority? There is nothing more patriotic than wanting to rid your country of injustice. And I think we can reclaim that argument, but in a way that is inclusive. Because when we talk about the majority by definition, and we want to build a society running the interests of the majority, the majority is made up of many minorities with their own specific problems and interests and injustices. The majority of the majority are women. So if you're a working class woman, you don't just suffer exploitation on the economic level. You suffer the increase, you suffer, you know, over a million women in Britain face domestic violence. 400,000 women are sexually assaulted a year. 90,000 women are raped. Women are more likely to have low paid and insecure jobs. Their services, talking about domestic violence, services for women are cut back. Similarly, with black and minority ethnic people across Europe, they've disproportionately suffered as a consequence of the cuts. In Britain, for a period, over half of all young black men were unemployed, and their unemployment rate doubled because of the crisis. Young black men, yeah, they're going to get exploited by their bosses like their white counterparts, but their white counterparts aren't likely to be stopped and searched for dubious reasons by the London police, for example. And it's the same with LGBT people. Yeah, they're going to get rubbish wages working in a supermarket, but they also can't hold hands off in the streets with their partners who they love. So my point is, when we're talking about being inclusive and identity and all the rest, I think you can talk about patriotism in a way that isn't chauvinistic, isn't racist, isn't imperialist, but is about saying we want to build a society run in the interest of the majority. That doesn't mean just talking about white working class men, as the left traditionally did seem to do. It means building a society run in the interest of the majority, white or black, working class or middle class, women, men. And that means having policies and visions that are specific to all the problems that we all face. And that's what we need to be talking about. We need an inclusive identity. My fear at the moment is the right are trying to portray us as people who hate working class people and who hate our own country. But that's not the tradition of the left at all. And if we allow them to do that, then we are finished. And we're finished all over Europe because they are trying to redefine national identity and class to mean proud English or whoever, working class people who are downtrodden, not because of their bosses, not because of bankers, not because of tax avoiders, but by immigration and the enablers, the middle class, cosmopolitan elite. So we need an answer to that. So we need to redefine identity. We need to redefine patriotism as much as we're uncomfortable with that. And to wrap up, because this is the end and I want a beer after this. Look, this is a very, very difficult time in human history. And we, you know, I said before, it's not about wallowing in defeat. It's not about pessimism. It is accepting the odds that we're up against. Because not since the end of World War II has the far right, the hard right, the xenophobic right been so emboldened. Yeah, we're celebrating, as I said, Austria. But it is frightening they got 46% of the vote, and Austria's going to have a parliamentary election soon. This was just for a figurehead. And they're in a good place, as things stand, to win. I don't think the old Blairite third way offers answers in the world in which we live. And they're not winning either. But it does mean, above all else, we've got to get our act together. We have a vision, and that is building a Europe and a world that is running the interests of the real wealth creators, working people, where we don't force people to pay for the crimes, the greed of a tiny elite, where we invest rather than cutting back services and rights that our ancestors fought for at such cost and such sacrifice, that we communicate in a way that doesn't just resonate with people who turn up to meetings like this, but reach all the people who don't spend cold, rainy December evenings talking about politics on a Sunday. And we can do this. We've done it before. What we were up against before, in the past, was far worse than what we're up against today. And the thing about history is, the way you get change is not by waiting for the charity and the goodwill and the generosity of the powerful. It's about the determination and courage of people from below. And when I mentioned all that before, and this country knows it better than most countries, the horror that people had to go through when they fought for democracy and justice, horror of a scale that few countries can ever speak about. But what that history tells us is social change, because we remember the people who fought for our rights and freedoms, not just because it's the right thing to do, which it is, and how lonely and hard it was, but because it shows us that change isn't a case of victory, success. It's often setback, defeat, and then victory. And those people who fought for democracy and human rights and basic justice in Europe, who didn't just suffer what we suffer today, they were tortured and persecuted and murdered in their millions. But history damns the people they were up against. And history is on their side. And it is a reminder that the determination and courage and resilience of our ancestors, who won every single right and freedom that we enjoy today, some of which are being chipped away without even a murmur. But it shows how we get change. And it is my absolute conviction that after this long, dark, cold winter that 2016 has been, that things can change, but only if we have the same determination, the same resilience, and the same courage that our ancestors, including in this country and my country, showed before. We will win in the end. History is going to be on our side. History does not belong to the Donald Trumps and the Nigel Farages and the Marine Le Pens. And history is going to be brutal and uncompromising in their damnation of those people. But it does depend on us getting our act together. So let's have the same determination, have the same courage. Let's not just turn up to these meetings. Let's go out into our communities, give people who need hope, that hope they desperately, all of them, are crying out for. And if we do that, as our ancestors won in the past, we are going to win all over again. But it is up to every single person in this room.
Ich freue mich, dass sozusagen hier so viele da waren, 2 Stunden lang, und es ist kein Regen an der Scheibe, sondern unser Atem, weil wir so viele sind hier im Raum. Und ich glaube, wir beenden jetzt einfach den Abend und trinken noch ein paar Bier. Tschüss.